1.26 million. We have the results. Okay, you two.
My name is Michelle McManus, and 20 years ago, I won a TV talent show called Pop Idol.
Michelle!
This is my dream, and you've made it come true, and thank you so much to everybody.
How could I have possibly imagined what was to come next? I had no idea.
My winner single soared to number one in the charts. And I received incredible support from the public.
It was an amazing experience. It changed the course of my life.
I'm going on a nostalgic journey into the world of TV talent shows.
More people voted for Pop Idol than voted at the general election.
Hello, darling.
You look amazing.
So do you.
Other than being Robbie Williams, the entity that is a pop star, I'm also a massive fan of TV.
Pop Idol sparked the revival of TV talent shows like The X Factor, Britain's Got Talent and A Voice. I'm meeting the Scots who took the world of TV talent shows by storm.
Nobody really knew what was going to happen. But when it did explode, whew.
To reflect on where we are now after all this time.
Have a look at question number 9. This is for £16,000. Here it comes. Who became the first Scottish solo singer to make her debut in the singles charts at number one?
I mean, the fact this is even a
Annie
question
Lennox,
on Who Wants a Millionaire is bonkers.
Lulu, Sheena Easton, Michelle McManus.
Look at the way he even says my name. He's like, what's she doing in here?
I'm going to play Lulu. Final answer.
He had £8,000. Eddie, you have just lost £7,000. Oh. Lulu's debut single was not a number one. Michelle McManus's was. I am so sorry. Top the charts
in
January 2004 with All This Time. Went straight to number one.
This is the official chart show. Yeah, Glasgow will be going wild tonight because Michelle is the new number one for 2004. Michelle, congratulations.
Thank you. I am over the moon.
All This Time got released in the January of 2004, and being given an original song was the greatest gift I could have received for winning that show. The song just went boom. It was a dream. That single was just, everyone kind of took it into their hearts at that time, and it just did so phenomenally well. We were going up and down the country, HMV, signing sleeves, signing all this kind of stuff. I didn't realise just how huge Pop Idol was as a show. I mean, you're talking tens of millions of viewers, and it was like the biggest show on telly at that time.
Joining us on the couch is Pop Idol winner 2003, none other than Michelle. How are you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you both?
Everyone was so excited, everyone was so happy. Every time I phoned home, my granny, I can't get moving up that chapel. People are wanting my autograph because I'm your granny. It was such a moment in time I wish I could bottle. It was just the most wonderful feeling.
She's had a number one hit and has just finished a UK tour. Not bad for someone who's only been famous for 5 minutes. Now Michelle McManus is getting ready.
Things like this just didn't happen to people like me.
I grew up in a family of four sisters, my mum and dad, in the east end of Glasgow. Honestly, it was like the Waltons.
Hi!
How are you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
The life that we lived in the area that we came from, you would never think anybody here was going to be famous because we were just
normal working class.
My
mum was an amazing singer, and that's who Michelle took her voice from.
My gran was the most incredible singer. I remember seeing my gran singing in chapel. I must have only been about 4 or 5 and she was up doing the Sam and I thought it was a concert.
You know, the singers I loved was kind of like Celine Dion and Mariah Carey and Ella Fitzgerald and all these people. And they didn't necessarily come from Bayliston in Glasgow. So never did I ever think it would be a possibility that somebody like me would be able to go on and ever achieve anything that I've achieved. But when I saw Pop Idol, I remember thinking, here, wait a minute.
Well, we've laughed and we've cried, but it's time to head to pastures new. It's time to head up the M1, onto the M62, take the M6 loop round to the A75 and A76. We'll turn right onto the A71 and finally up the M74, which will take us to...
Torquay! Glasgow!
Glasgow!
So I remember really vividly when I decided to audition for Pop Idol. I was a waitress in a cocktail bar and I got a really rare Saturday night off. And this show called Pop Idol was on. How had it passed me by? But it had. And it was Will and Gareth in the final. I could not believe that this was a singing competition that anybody could enter. So the strap came up along the bottom of the screen saying, if you would like to enter, call this number. And I called the number.
Well, we're in Glasgow and I've got a good feeling about today.
I've got
to find a Pop Idol today.
Yes, there's a lot of talent in this room.
Why are you our Pop Idol, Michelle?
I'm a Pop Idol because I won my first £5 when I was 3 years old at Morecambe Bay and I've never wanted to do anything else. I've got the voice.
It doesn't say that on the Frank Sinatra bio, does it?
It doesn't, no, it doesn't. I want this and I'm going to do it.
I think if you remember one funny thing, Michelle, when you told me, Dad, if I get through here, I will be going on live shows on a Saturday night down there. And I went, oh, wait a minute, darling. You've got your job today.
I know that.
And I said, you're going to have to think about this serious. I said, because I was the old steady dad going, wait a minute.
For all the joy you brought to my life, for all the wrong that you made right.
You're through to the next round.
Thank you so much. I will do this.
You were moving through first week, second week.
Everybody was buzzing, do you know what I mean?
At any one time, Michelle, I had 100 posters. Right, I'm not kidding you. I had 100 posters. Saturday night, Pop Idol, support Michelle.
So what have we come as this week?
Well, we didn't have any sort of theme this week, so we thought we'd just come up as three idols from pop. So I thought I'd just maybe come as Rod Stewart for a change.
Right.
And have a wee go at it, but I don't want to show you my leopard-skin shorts here, but we'll forget that.
They were amazing. How did they ever afford it? I never stopped to ask where they found the money for that. That must have been hundreds of pounds a week, and that was not money my mum and dad had.
But you just kept a lot of stuff, you Pop Idol.
Oh, you know your dad's a hoarder, he doesn't throw anything away.
You kept everything. Aye. You should have a wee look at it.
And we should.
The original Pop Idol bag from the...
Dad, I cannot believe you have kept this.
And I don't even know what's inside it.
Yeah.
Pop Idol.
Bottle opener.
Pop Idol mug.
What's this, Michelle?
Look at that picture of me.
But darling, that's it, you're a natural girl.
You.
That'd be just you.
Unnatural.
No, but girl. Down, you were, I mean, you were me. You know what I mean?
I'm so young. And there you go. And this is when the headlines start. It's the Sun Wednesday, September, larger than life diva. Best girl singer on the show by far, says Sharon Hendry. But she's big, beautiful, and looks set to throw her weight behind this cinematic change in pop history for the very beginning.
So from really early on in the competition, I was aware that my weight was, pardon the pun, a huge problem. You know, being overweight was just, it was a kind of stick to beat you with. It was the first thing the media picked up on. And I remember being gutted that they hadn't said I was a good singer.
And then look at this, Dominic Mohan at the bottom. Great voice, but size does matter. I mean, I never stood a chance.
Never stood a chance.
Don't get me wrong, Michelle can sing. I'm sorry though, she ain't no Pop Idol. Appealing personality, good voice, but you just wouldn't, would you? Imagine you could never talk about a lassie like that now.
No.
Of course, darling.
That's actually quite shocking to read that.
We always felt that it doesn't matter what anybody says, it's us that matter to you.
It's all about your voice, darling. If people like the way you sing, that's what it's all about to us.
You said it, Dad. It absolutely should be all about the voice. And on that note, I simply have to check in Scotland's most famous talent show contestant, the one and only Susan Boyle.
Hello, how you doing? Come on in.
Good to see you, cheers.
Your career and everything that you've achieved, it does stand above the rest, you know, and it's been a joy for us to watch, but I'm always just so fascinated what it's been like for you to live it.
I would do it all over again.
So what made you decide I'm going to go for this show?
Well, I went for the show because my mother wanted me to do something with singing. She's a good singer, hey, come on. You know?
And you just thought, listen, I'm going to do it now?
Well, there's another reason as well.
What?
Fancy's Piers Morgan.
Piers Morgan?
Aye. I says, I'm going to meet this guy. I don't know how, but I'm going to meet him.
How old are you, Susan?
I am 47. And that's just one side of me.
Well, my expectations at that time weren't very, very good. Because I didn't really fit the mould. Like a pop star. I mean, let's face it, what was I like?
But I never saw you like that. I think isn't it sad sometimes that when we're going on to a singing competition that we're worrying about how we're looking? Because, I mean, your voice was just... It was like an angel. It was like the minute you started singing and you could not fake that reaction in the room.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
I had no idea it went so viral until somebody told me, you know.
Susan, what was it like when all the media started showing up at your door?
It was a wee bit embarrassing because I was skint at the time. I was on the dole. All these TV companies were coming up to my door.
Did you ever think you were going to get that as far as you did?
Well, to be honest, no. I mean, nobody really knew what was going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But when it did explode, whew.
It's a musical feat matched only by the Beatles and the Monkees. Now the singing sensation Susan Boyle has joined their ranks by becoming the first woman to top the UK and US album charts for a second time in a year.
Who are your favourite artists to sing? Because you've got an incredible range on you vocally.
Elaine Page.
Oh, of course. You got to meet Elaine Page and duet with Elaine Page. See, I always wanted to sing the Elaine Page part, but I...
Wasn't it good?
So good.
Wasn't he fine?
Oh, so fine. Madness, he can't be mine. I've sang with Susan Boyle.
Yeah,
I love it. Thank you, my love.
That's all.
I think the thing about you, Susan, is you're authentic. You're exactly who you say you are.
You never judge a book by a cover anyway. I'm a champion for other people who could really, you know, had a wee bit of hesitation and going, you know.
And you were, by the way, and I feel a wee bit like that, like myself, you know, because at the time, because it was a singing competition, I genuinely thought at 23 I could go on and sing and nobody would notice that I was a size 22 or 24.
And you were very misjudged at times. You're a bit like myself. A wee bit misjudged, but brilliant.
Praise indeed from Susan, a Scottish talent show legend whose 2009 audition made history and inspired another Scot to enter Britain's Got Talent just a few years later.
The winner of Britain's Got Talent 2011 is...
Winning against Ronan Park, who at the time was a 12-year-old child, was slightly heartbreaking, even for me. I'm Jai McDowell, and I'm the winner of Britain's Got Talent 2011. I discovered I could sing when I was really young, and I sang I Will Always Love You by Whitney Houston. Why I knew that at 9 years old, I don't know, but I did.
We went to Gran Canaria one year for my holidays. We were doing a karaoke and he came up and he said, can I sing, Mum? Right, when you go then, get a go. And the place stood up. We were really...
Aye, he nailed it. He definitely did. You can hear a pin drop.
I always just used to like doing things my own way. Nowadays, I think that's more celebrated, which is great. Growing up on the west coast of Scotland, it wasn't really the coolest thing to do. So
he only really had like one good friend as such.
He was a kind of introvert, quite a shy individual.
my dad noticed that I could sing and decided to take me around with his band at the time. I thought, right, well, this is fun, it made me happy. And so I thought, you know, if I can do this as a career, that would be great.
If I can control my voice, then everything should be okay.
The very first audition, I don't remember much about it because I think I was so nervous.
He wasn't really wanting to go, but we actually pushed him to go. Obviously, that year he won. Save me from the nothing I become. Bring
me to life.
To have the voice he's got now is just incredible.
He was 10 weeks premature. They said to us he would have problems, and he was 16 weeks in intensive care. This was the size of his body, with his two wee legs and two wee arms and a head. Both his lungs collapsed, and he got a strep infection. No other wee babies in the baby unit survived. He did.
Never thought he would ever have a voice like that.
I'm still doing a job that I absolutely love. I have just joined the X Factor group G4 and recorded an album for their 20th anniversary. One of the wonderful things is that I've made lots of friends through talent shows. When I'm home in air, I perform with the McDonald brothers who were on X Factor. As if I should become a stranger,
know that it would make me more sad. Joy! Caledonia's been everything I've
ever had. See a big difference in. He's more confident.
It's such a great thing because you never know where your life's going to end up when you go on one of these shows.
I couldn't agree more.
Tomorrow night, two become one, you decide. Oh. We'll see you tomorrow night. May the best man and woman win. Good night. Thank you.
It's time to go back to London, where it all began for me in 2003.
Kate Thornton was the presenter of Pop Idol Extra, right? This was a sister show that ran in conjunction with Pop Idol. We had the live show on the Saturday night, and we had the ITV2 Extra stuff that ran every night.
I haven't seen Kate Thornton in 20 years.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, you're going to make me cry. Hello, lovely.
Happy tears, I hope.
Really happy tears. I think it's because I think there's so few people really understand what that time was like.
Listen, you walked into an audition room and you never walked back to being who you were.
Mm.
Everything changed from that moment on. And I think we were one season in, so we'd already had one go at this,
mm-hmm.
and it had knocked us off our feet.
The winner of Pop Idol 2002 is Will!
It was just a show that captured the public imagination in a way that we hadn't seen. We were invited to Parliament to advise, you know, the government on how to get young people to vote because more people voted for Pop Idol than voted at the general election. It was insane. Darius deserves a very special mention, the comeback kid. Because, I mean, he had been rinsed on
the
Pop Stars Survivals.
Yeah.
He was a meme before memes were even invented, yeah. And he volunteered himself back into the public spotlight. He was very powerful in showing people you can change your own narrative just by being a good person with some talent.
Dearly departed Darius became a national treasure after finishing third on Pop Idol Series 1. Against all odds, this lovable rogue from Scotland had made it into the final stages of the contest and went to number one with his brilliant song, Colourblind.
I had no expectation going into this show. I was like a wee dumpy girl, 23 years old from Scotland. There was no way I thought I was ever even in my chance of winning. I thought, I'm going to be on this for a week or two and go back and tell my pals and I'm going to be dining out in this for like the rest of my life.
Can I just rewind on something, right? You say you were just a wee dumpy girl from Scotland. That's not what I saw. What I saw was somebody that lit up the camera with this incredible voice, but the personality to match. And you engendered goodwill. People fell in love with you.
So we found our two finalists, Mark and Michelle, but we hit the streets to find out who your favourite is.
I like Michelle. I think she's an inspiration.
There's not that many people in the music industry like her.
I think she's got a really good voice and I think she's quite gutsy to stay in this long.
Michelle's different and she's amazing.
My favourite is Michelle because she's not your run-of-the-mill, typical pop idol Barbie doll.
I think Michelle should be the overall champion. And she's gorgeous.
Please choose Michelle because she's great, she's got a great voice, and there needs to be more people like her.
Here we go now. The moment of truth has arrived.
So we stood there and it goes, and the winner of Pop Idol is... And then I could look at you, I look at... It's Mark, wasn't
Mark,
it?
Yeah. Yeah.
That music bed. And then the gallery put it in our ear and we couldn't react. And I was just like,
I wish she'd give me the eye or something.
The crew weren't in on it. Everybody was being told to hold the shots. All I remember is just stood there side of stage and I thought, just stare into the distance, don't show your face. But I was just thinking, go on, Michelle. Go on, Michelle. And then turn around and bang.
Michelle!
And then that ticker tape came down. I had the stickiest lip gloss on, known to mankind.
It was filling it out, didn't we all? Back then, MAC lip gloss.
Part of me was like, has this really happened? Have I really won? Because there was kind of stuff looming in the background. I don't know what had happened. Maybe it's because Pete had stormed out. Something had happened.
So... What a big one that was. Where's Pete?
Wasn't it? Pete had to go to the loo. He's been dying.
Pete Waterman had already stormed off. Like, the minute I won, he didn't even save my performance. He kind of ripped his mic off and just stormed out the studio. Pete Waterman had an issue with me right from the beginning.
I think you are not a pop idol. You will never be a pop idol. That's my opinion.
Pete came from a world where it was Sonia and Kylie and all these really beautiful people. And then you had someone like me. And I tried to laugh it off at the time, but that broke my heart.
I'm really sorry for that, because you should have still been walking around in a confetti cloud of ticker tapes. What those people should have been paying attention to was the number, and I mean the millions of people that voted for you, because they didn't speak for the nation. The nation spoke for you. And you changed things, Michelle, just by being you.
Beautiful Kate has not changed one bit.
So, from all of us on the show, have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Thanks for watching.
Pop Idol came to an end after Series 2.
From me and all of us, good night.
Soon to be replaced by the new Saturday night show in town, The X Factor.
They've written their own song. First time they've done it, they're insistent about it. Could be a risk, or it could be the best thing they've ever done. We're going to find out. I think it's going to be a good thing. It's the Cut Kelvins.
Hey, I'm Shireen Cut Kelvin, and I was a semi-finalist in the X Factor 2017 with my brothers, the Cut Kelvins. I was looking for something better. It just feels like it just went, whoosh, it was all like a kind of X Factor bubble. Kind of look back, and you're like, did that actually happen? It's a experience that you can only get on these kind of talent shows, and it's got its ups and downs.
It's a really tough night tonight. The Cut
because 2 out of 5 are going home. And everybody in Scotland, lift your phones and vote. We want them here next week.
My dad is the inspiration in all things that I do musically. He was just incredible. He was in a lot of different bands throughout his life and was first signed by Tam Payton, who also managed the Bay City Rollers. Sang with Dionne Warwick, Benny King, and so close to making it absolutely massive that he really deserved it. And he's just been the most incredible singer I've ever known in my entire life. I know I am a little bit biased, but honestly, just top tier. Growing up, we had like a major shock to our whole world. Like, it was just turned upside down completely. We lost our dad quite young. I was just turned 14 at the time. And then a year later, that's when I started my girl band and started getting signed, and it felt like all the years of work that I'd been doing with my dad, I came to something, but unfortunately he wasn't there to experience it. But that's been like the kind of passion and the fight that's kept us going all through the years, all through like ups and downs, because we've had so many opportunities over the years where it's like you almost make it, and a lot of people that go through that would just give up after that. But really, that's when you've got to keep pushing on. We're back for another year, and once again, the nation has delivered. 4 talented finalists have fought through hundreds of entries to secure a spot on this stage tonight. I work for BBC Introducing in Scotland, and we champion all the new artists coming out in Scotland. Tonight's show is packed with new uploads from Becky Sakasa. I'm in the radio studio till 10 p.m. on a Friday night. Then Saturday morning, I'm back at BBC for 5 a.m. I present a kids' TV show called Saturday Mashup that goes out live on CBBC. So you get to be a kid live on TV, you get to slime people. That's a lot of fun.
What's a cocktail of this up to now?
Yeah. Oh, Branch, we're on!
I can't stop the feeling that you're about to start singing.
Oh, Branch, don't you...
Got to grind, you got to... I know sometimes my dad would be out singing, and then, you know, other times you might not have food on the table, but it's just the way the industry goes. He was such a grafter, and I knew I would have to do the same thing.
We're working hard, but we've got work to do, Joe, here on Mashup. We've got
to give up now and to give up a dream. It's just not an option.
Massive respect to Shireen. 20 years on, and I'm still grafting.
Right, are you ready for some music? Please give a warm welcome to the wonderful Michelle McManus.
I've been invited to talk about my pop idol experience on the Loose Women live tour, so I thought I need to give them a song.
So that experience of pop idol, it was kind of good and bad for you, wasn't it? Bit of a poison challenge.
It was honestly the most incredible thing that ever happened to me, and I would never have won if it wasn't for a lot of people sitting in this room tonight who... I still get wee women stop me in Tesla going, Hen, you were amazing, but my phone got cut off for 3 months after that.
Do you think you would have either entered it now or won it now? Do you think it would have been different?
Knowing what I know now, I don't think I would enter again, so I don't think I'd be...
Wow.
Let's go back to 2003. Things weren't looking so rosy after my win.
I just can't believe this has happened, and I just want to thank everyone that's voted, and this is my dream, and you've made it come true, and thank you so much to everybody. I don't even know where I'm looking.
What came next is actually kind of sad. It's almost like at the end of the movie when everyone gets their happily ever after and what happens next. And the reality probably isn't what you want to hear.
pillars. Pillar?
Pillar or pill?
Don't look at him and say pillar.
I mean, just look at the judges' reaction. And they're all there. They're really nervous, I think. When you look at them all, they're so nervous.
Winner's single will be out in January, is that right?
Yes, it is. Yes. Yep. 5th of January.
5th of January. And an album will follow shortly, I'm sure.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Too many
roads. Sadly, there was a lot of truth in what Pete said. You weren't going to make it as a singer in 2003 if you looked like me, and that came to pass. And I think the second single kind of limped to number 13. And they just kind of said, well, you know, that's it then. That's the journey over.
It felt to me like the record company checked out as soon as all this time left the charts.
I felt like everything was my fault. It was my fault that I was overweight. It was my fault I wasn't attractive enough. It was my fault that the press hadn't taken to me the way I thought they would after winning. I remember one specific time, I was at an event. Robbie Williams was there, and he was the kindest person in my life at that specific moment in time. Here's this megastar, pulls up a chair beside me, and he's like, you all right? I watched the talent show. I loved you. I thought you were brilliant. He loved talent shows. And he sat and spoke to me about the industry, how difficult it was, about how bad the press could be, how not to let it get to you. And he left. It's my 20th anniversary of winning Pop Idol.
Yeah.
And we are looking at my journey over 20 years and just talent shows in general. Right at the beginning of my journey, you were one of the first people that was a global megastar that I'd ever met. And was so incredibly kind.
You know, other than being Robbie Williams, the entity that is a pop star, I'm also a massive fan of TV. Mm-hmm. So I would have just spent weeks with you. So you would have been a star in my mind too. I saw you do your thing. I really enjoyed it. And then I saw how you were treated and just thought, obviously, I know how that feels and it's not okay. And I've always thought about you and wondered how you are and, you know, what that felt like for you.
He was so incredibly kind to me at a point in my life when lots of people involved in that industry were not very kind. I want to talk to you about how this all came about with you being a judge on X Factor, right? First of all, right, how does X Factor get someone like you?
I'm impulsive and I say the first thing that comes to my mind, what if that gets me in trouble? What if it gets me cancelled? Oh my God, you couldn't pay me to do that. Mm-hmm. Well, it turns out they could. let me tell you what happened.
Wait, tell me.
So, love the show. Always love the show. And, you know, I just find Simon just absolutely fascinating. Mm-hmm. And who is this guy? What is this guy? What is he? How is he doing this? You know? And then what they did was this. They phone up Ida.
Oh.
And Ida phones up me. Boo! Guess what? What? I've just been offered X Factor with you, Boozy. My wife's the most important person in my life. And, you know, she's a showman too, show person. And when she comes and she goes, well, they want me to do it and you. And I'm like, do you know what? I did it for Ida.
See that whole audition process? Did you audition to get into Take That?
I tell you about my audition for Take That. So I make a CV and lie. And always lie in your CV, folks. That's why I'm here. And then send it off to the manager. I had an unsuccessful sit down with him. And I walked to the door after he said goodbye, opened the door, and I turned to look at him and I didn't know what to do. And he looked at me and I just went. And because of that wink, he then brought me back to see me. He was like, oh, maybe he's got something. That was cheeky. If it wasn't for that wink.
Sliding doors moment.
This wouldn't have happened, yeah. Oh,
but Robbie Williams' wink.
Yeah, what a winker.
What a winker. What a winker.
all I had was a twinkle in my eye and a dream. So my story in itself should be proof to you that this can happen. There's never been a better time on the planet to be someone.
You're touring at the moment. Are you going to be home for Christmas? Do you enjoy Christmas?
I love it.
I'm obsessed with Christmas.
It could start in September for me.
I'm the same.
I didn't used to be like that, but my wife is imbued with the spirit of Christmas, mm-hmm. and she's shown me how to love, and she's shown me how to love that season too. I absolutely adore Christmas. For once in your life, maybe. And when the kids came, I'm better because of them.
Mm. I mean, you had this amazing Christmas album that you brought out.
It's my favourite album that I've done.
Is it?
Yeah.
I love a lot, I mean, kind of all your work, but I love your Christmas album.
Bless you, thank you.
Did you have a lot of fun making that?
Yeah.
Does it get played in the Williams household at Christmas?
Yeah, it does, yeah. Narcissistically, that's all.
No,
yeah.
I bet your wee ones love it, Daddy.
Oh, no, we've got loads of different traditions that we have that Ida's brought in, and one of them I've brought in, and that's the playing of my Christmas album.
Sure, you should.
And I don't listen to any of my records, but I'll listen to the Christmas album. Yeah, I wasn't expecting to adore the process as much as I did, but I did, you know. And I think that's because when you're writing a Christmas album, you exist in a happy place because you're happy at Christmas.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Good to know it's your favourite album.
Yeah.
Robbie, it's been amazing to chat to you, and I can't tell you what it means, so thank you very much.
A privilege and a pleasure, and thank you for your love back to me, and I feel the same way about you. You're a beautiful soul.
Mr. Robbie Williams, the feeling is so mutual. Right, it's time to check in with another Scottish X Factor favourite.
OK, judges, contestants, people of Britain, this is it. I can now reveal the winner of the X Factor 2013 is...
I'm Nicholas McDonald, and I was runner-up on X Factor 2013.
I just want to say thank you to absolutely every single person who's voted for me.
That year, X Factor lowered the applicant age from age 18 to 16. So I signed up, I applied, I was still at school, I had no idea kind of what I was doing with my life, and me and my family always grew up with a takeaway. We'd sit round a Saturday night and watch the show, and we absolutely loved it. And I thought, why not? I'm 16, let's apply for it. Let's see how it goes.
Hi, Nicholas. How are you?
Oh, I'm really nervous.
Are you?
Yeah.
Meeting the judges for this first time, seeing them actually there in person, was the craziest thing ever. From going from watching it one year from my living room to then being on it was just totally mind-blowing. And I just remember seeing Nicole Scherzinger for the first time and being like, she's hotter in real life than she is actually on the TV, believe it or not. My whole family was there. I'll never forget when I looked over, Nicole Scherzinger was like bawling her eyes crying. Before the final, they took me back to my school for a homecoming gig. The place was going absolutely wild. Seeing all my classmates there and all the support I got from the hometown was just incredible.
It's weird to think that I'm coming back as a finalist in X Factor. I never ever thought I'd do that, and now I'm here doing it. It's like, well, I'm actually here doing it.
It's been a complete whirlwind from the X Factor final to doing my own tours, to singing in arenas, singing all over the world. One week I could be singing at a charity ball. The next week I could be singing A Beautiful Bride Down the Aisle.
He was like, I've got a surprise for you. And I was like, all right, okay. And then and I went, oh my God, that's Nicholas McDonald. And he went, I know. And I just burst out crying.
I'm now married 5 years to my beautiful wife, Brandy. We met on a cruise ship when I was singing, she was a guest.
I don't need to iron the sleeves of that, right?
Just iron it all.
My wife moves from Florida to Wishaw, and that's love.
I ended up just scrolling way back on your Instagram. Mm-hmm. One night, I'll literally never forget it. I was like in bed and I just scrolled and I was like, what the heck? I was like, does that say X Factor? Once I found that out, I was just like, oh, okay. And I could tell you didn't want to talk about it. And I was like, okay, well then I'm not going to force you to talk about it.
A few years after the show, I think things obviously start to slow down and what starts to dry up and, you know, you kind of get down in the dumps about yourself and you start second guessing yourself. And it wasn't until I met my wife that she really started, she believed in me from the minute she met me.
Sometimes I undersell myself.
You like downplay how good you are. I feel like to make yourself, because you get insecure talking about it. Like, I know. And you're like, oh, I'm an X Factor reject and all that, don't you? He always says that. And I'm like, that drives me crazy. Because I'm like, you're so much more than that. Like, you actually are like raw talent. And I feel like you forget that. You just say X Factor reject. And it's like, okay, get that out of your head because you're a really good singer. And if you don't back yourself, who's going to back you besides me? That.
She gives me the confidence to believe in myself and really push me to be a better man, a better person, a better singer. I think the good thing to come out of X Factor was that I'm punching away above my weight because my wife's a 10 out of 10. I'm very happy. Life's great with a strong partner that I've got and my wife and a strong family and a bit more belief in myself. The future is definitely looking bright.
It's so important to have a support network after you come off a show like that. After I get dropped by my record label, I found myself in London pretty much alone.
There was one community that literally just opened their arms up and went, come here, Hen, come and see us, because we think you're brilliant. And that was the LGBTIQ plus community.
So please give her the biggest love that you can do. It's Michelle McManus!
And one of the many members of that community who remains a really dear friend is Edward Reed.
You go to any major event, Edward Reed is hosting it. And he's so talented. And he had done so well on Britain's Got Talent.
Hello.
Hi.
Welcome to Britain's Got Talent.
Thank you.
I remember standing at the side of the stage and there was a lot of and the audience were going off, off, off. Oh, and it was like getting... I felt as if it was like the Roman times, getting thrown to the lions. I felt as if that's what it was like. So when I remember standing going, I'm going to get here and sing about Humpty Dumpty. I'm going to get annihilated. Twinkle, twinkle, little star. How bright you are. Up above the clouds, so high. They can boo me, they can buzz me, but as Whitney says, they can't take away my dignity. So I...
Clap your hands!
Do you remember that time in your life where it literally, because it felt to me watching it like it went like that for you, bang?
Not for me it didn't, because in that weekend that it came out, it was a bit overwhelming, but then it died down and I was like, I thought my life was going to change like that, but it didn't, so it took a while.
You know, it's so funny you say that, right? Because I thought, like, the minute I won, I was just going to fly to LA, Brad Pitt was going to see you and be like, you're the one for me, and get married, and I was going to live in one of those, like, mansions. And that never happened for me, and my career kind of went, right down. But then what brought me back up was the LGBTIQ plus community. Mm-hmm. Nobody would book me for love nor money, but I started getting booked for Pride. You know, all these big gay bars and all the rest of it. Because that community just said, it doesn't matter if nobody else is wanting you now, we definitely want you. And I have never forgot that.
I'm joined by the original reality singer,
success. Honestly, I love her to bits. It's Michelle McManus. How are you?
I'm very well, my darling. That's a lovely intro. Thank you very much.
You're a legend. Absolute legend.
Our community, it's like, we know what it's like to be rejected. We know what it's like when we're terrified or we feel lonely in the community. So when we see somebody, and I think especially, well, as a gay man, if I see a woman in that vulnerable position, I'm like, oh, no, 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 she needs help. And I think that's what our community does. So we see the vulnerability, we see the fear in somebody, and it resonates inside us.
The love that was coming back to me from this community, it completely healed me, I think, as a person. And I didn't realise how much I needed that, but I really needed it.
I think we like people in society that take risks. Mm-hmm. You just went in this talent show and against all odds, you won it, you know what I mean? And it was just like this, it was almost like personality, the talent and the beauty shone through. But years ago, we used to measure beauty in different ways. And now, thankfully, we're measuring it in the real way. So you were probably a trailblazer, Michelle. And that's why I think you're loved. You're fabulous.
Something started to change at that point, really started to change. I was starting to be seen in a different light, and I wasn't the butt of jokes. I wasn't opening up the papers, and it wouldn't start with, you know, big and bubbly Michelle McManus. It was just singer Michelle. Things started to change. I started to get asked to do the Eurovision result. I got Children in Need, and then I met Ford and Greg from Still Game, who are, like, iconic.
Oh, sorry, Michelle, love. I left a message in an answering machine now. I got Jim Watt.
Right, no bother.
A couple of years later, I got Scott Squad, which was a huge big show thanks to the lovely Grado.
In this job, you expect to deal with the public, but you never think you'll ever deal with Pop Idol winner 2003, Michelle McManus. Number one hit with all this time.
I started to get offered jobs in radio.
Oh, that music can mean just one thing.
In TV. I was offered Panto. I even found myself starring alongside David Hasselhoff. Yes, the Hoff.
I was invited to sing for the Pope when he visited Scotland.
I co-wrote a one-woman show at the Edinburgh Festival with my friend Bruce Devlin, and it totally sold out.
But I've came to that point in the show after singing the two emotional songs and just how rubbish my love life is. I've decided, ladies and gentlemen, that I'm going to have to drop the C-bomb, OK, and then that's it done, right? One, two, three... Cowl.
We came up with this character, you know, this woman that had been famous for 15 minutes but wasn't famous anymore, but she didn't know she wasn't famous anymore.
And I remember the last thing he ever said to me that night when I won, he took me up to the green room and he said, Michelle, I am going to take care of you. That was a lie.
That allowed me to really be really self-deprecating through this character. But it was all my experiences, right, of being, you know, not loved and unattractive.
Hands up if you're in love in this room. Who's in love? Let me see you. Yes, let's get the light on you. So happy for you.
The media storm around Pop Idol definitely stopped me from having proper relationships for sure. But this was me taking back power, and people really seemed to love it. My friend's show ran for 6 years, and in that time, we saw the TV talent show evolve once more. The Voice UK put singing ability first and image second. Contestants are heard before they are seen.
Cause if I could see your face once more.
I am Stevie McCrory. I won The Voice in 2015. I'm 29, from Scotland, and I'm a firefighter.
Guys for the fire service heard me sing, and they were like, you can actually sing. They applied for The Voice for me, and I was kind of like, no chance I'm doing that. Wee bit nervous. Never kind of believed in myself with singing with that kind of thing. Eventually I went for it, and here we are now. If you love me, why'd you leave me?
Take my body, take
to your first voice audition and you weren't too sure, were you? I don't think any of us were too sure, to be honest.
Aye, I remember you saying to me like you weren't sure because like I was like a warrior.
I just didn't think I wanted you to be disappointed.
Aye.
Because I knew how hard it would be to even get on TV or how hard any it would be, and I didn't want you to be disappointed, but...
Aye, it worked out, though.
It worked out, yeah. It did.
And you took it well with the Rita Ora thing as well.
I did,
laughed it off.
I laughed it off.
Yep.
Knew it would make good TV.
Yeah.
Give me a second, because I had something to say, and now you're just standing like that, and your legs are like that. And you've got tattoos on your arms, and, you know, they're music notes. You're really hot.
I've never heard anybody call me hot before.
I never heard,
Apart for you.
Apart for me.
The artist with the most viewer votes tonight and therefore winner of The Voice 2015 is...
Stevie!
When I won it, I got a lump sum. I managed to move from a wee tin house to a brick house closer to the hills in Alva. And I got a record deal, so I worked on my album with David Sneddon, who won Fame Academy. He sits alone at a table and a small coffee. Drowning his tears. I never thought a working class boy from Stirlingshire would actually one day be in the charts. It was just an amazing experience, and it's one I'll never forget. I left home today. And I saw your face in the window pane. I'm on my way, and I'm already counting down the days. Turn around. When I was down in London, I used to just write songs pretty much about missing BB, my wee girl. When I say I'm coming home, I'll always tell the truth, cause my heart, when I'm with you, never lies. When I won The Voice and got a bit of fame, wrote my album, it was almost like I realised the grass wasn't any greener on the other side, and that my family was the most important thing. And I ended up having another little daughter called Sunny, and I wrote another song about her. In days like these, I'm gonna miss these days. So, oh, Sunny. It was called Days Like These, and it's just really about enjoying life as much as you can in the special moments, because I realised how quick BB grew up with that wee tote. The moments that I cherish the most are like really simple stuff, like just I'm always doing the school pickup, I love it.
Are you looking forward to your holiday?
Yeah.
In the caravan?
All that matters to me is being a good dad and being a good role model to them and being there for my wife, so I'm just a big softie when it comes to my girls, and yeah. Aye. Hey, what else? Don't know what to greet.
I think it's dad for dad.
Dad? I'm not at your school, I'm too big.
So when it came to the ultimatum to go back to the fire service, it was a pretty easy decision. It's an amazing job. I get to be part of people's lives and ultimately like save people's lives at times. You don't need to be like super famous, and you can just be a normal person and be happy.
Oh, Stevie, honestly, what would we do without our key workers, especially at Christmas? Being happy with your lot is a feeling I'm also now thankfully familiar with. Something really wonderful happened to me in 2015. I was 35 and I was starting to think I will literally never meet anyone. My lovely friend Kat Harvey phoned me and she was like, right, Scotland are playing tonight. So I went and met her and we were in a pub in Shawland and walked this guy.
Genuinely did actually break the ice by saying, McManus, can I get a picture
I look back at that picture now and it makes me smile so much because I have the moment that my life completely changed forever. 8 years on, I'm married and I have two of the most beautiful boys you've ever seen. They're gorgeous, Harry and Nicholas. What was my life before them? They're amazing. I love being a mummy. I love doing this with Jeff, and Jeff allowed me to accept the fact someone could love me and love me for the way I look and the way that I am. And, you know, for such a long time, I just felt you know, very unworthy. I just felt like, you know, when you're constantly told you're so fat and you're so ugly and no one will ever want you, it does get in. So when someone presents themselves that's so lovely and such an incredible human being like Jeff, who does love you for you, it really helped me in so many ways just to really love myself again as well. I decided this year I would write and record a Christmas single. I have wanted to release new music for years and years and years, and I've never had the courage to do it because it was really traumatising the first time around. Raise your glass and celebrate, cos Christmas time is really here. But there's something really safe about Christmas. I don't need this single to do anything. It just needs to be for me, and if anyone else enjoys it, then what a great bonus that is. This time of year, I truly take stock of what matters. Fame, money, status, it doesn't change anything. It doesn't bring you the happiness that you think it will. The things that really make a difference in your life are the real things that you can hold and that you can touch and that you can interact with. So for me, it's my family. It's my husband, it's my children. It's doing the job I love. It's my amazing supportive friends. It's taken me 20 years to process and accept and actually look back so fondly at that time. That whole journey that my career has went on and to the point I'm at right now, and I look back and I'm really proud and I feel really lucky that even after 20 years, after all this time, there is still so much love surrounding me. Yeah.